Hello, come on in. Throw up a praise when you come in. Greet me as you come in. Greet each other. Greet me as you come in. Let's go. Hey, 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 everybody. Happy Thursday. Happy Thursday, everybody. Happy Thursday. What's going on, Elder Reed? What's up? Throw up a praise. Praise God. Happy Thursday. You said it's going well. Awesome. I trust that you have had a phenomenal day today. The Lord is good. He's kind. And his blessings endure to all generations. I'm going to take a moment and share with some people, inviting you to do the same thing. Share, share, share. Share. That's right. Go ahead. And share. I'm sharing. Are you sharing? Take a few moments and share with some people. Let them know their blessing is here. Let them know. Let them know. This blessing is going down. Blessing is going down. How was your day today? Come on in with a praise. Letting me know how your day was, how your week has been. It's Friday Eve. Praising. It's Friday Eve, and I'm thankful. So let's get some people in. Let's invite some folks to come in. Come on in. Blessings to you that are already joined. I give God glory for you that are here today and those that will see the notification will come on in. I thank the Lord for those of you that have come in on tonight. I am trusting all is well with you because everything concerning me is well. And I give God the praise for that on tonight. I give God the praise on tonight. What's up? Good evening, sister. How art thou? How you doing? Sister Baker, my Duval clan. Praise God. He is good. He is good. Are there any testimonies to be shared? Is there any good news to be shared? I do have a couple of things that I want to ask in the last 12 months, those of you that have been, we've been on this journey for a little bit together. I want to ask you what your favorite series or topic has been since we've been together. It's been over a year. I believe I started doing this March or April of last year. So we're beyond a year. And I'm definitely prayerful as to how to proceed. If this is something that God wants me to continue to do. How you doing, Pastor Saunders, Elder Saunders? God bless you. Good to see you on tonight. It's a blessing that as many leaders stop by. It's a lot of leaders that seem to stop by. So I give God the praise and the glory for that. I want to ask you, what topic or series blessed you the most? What topic or series blessed you the most? Which one has impacted you the most? That's what I'm curious to know. So while you thinking about that, put a praise in the atmosphere, put the praise hands up as we go forward on tonight. We have a lot of things to bless the Lord for. He's rich, he's kind, he's mighty. He is so gracious and patient with us. And yours truly is on a 13-day countdown. Yes, the time is now 13 days. 13 days. We got 13 days. My little corny noises. But I am having a birthday. Where your hands at? Where your hands at? Where your hands at? Where your hands at? Go up, go up, go up. A little corny, but that's my little celebration. I am definitely celebrating. Hey, to my own rhythm, to my own beat, because I have so much to thank God for. I'm truly happy to be crossing over into another decade. Truly don't look like or feel like what I have been through. And I give God the praise. How you doing, Peace Lily? The Peace Lily is in the building. Praise the Lord. Sister London, good to see you. And to my brother, Elder Smith, love you. Praying for you. Praying for you. Praying for your wife. Praying for the Smith family all together. And I will be in unison and present with you as we talked about. So to God be the glory. To God be the glory. So, hey, yes, yours truly is the 13-day countdown. So you have a couple of questions on the floor. How you doing, little sister? Rotisha out in Little Rock, Arkansas. So I got Georgia. I got Little Rock. I got Jacksonville. Anybody else from different places, just chime in and let us know where you are tuning in from. We had a little trivia going on. I asked you in the year, the 12 months, that we have been hanging out in this space together on Thursday nights and on Sundays. What has been the biggest blessing? All right, South Carolina. Oh, wow, you're in South Carolina. Wow, okay. I don't know. For some reason, I thought you were in Georgia. Peace, Lily, for real. All right, Alabama is in the region. All right, is it? You're in the building. God bless you. Thank you for joining us all the way in Alabama. I guess depending on where you are in Alabama, that might be a 2-hour drive for me. Maybe you might want to meet me at the border with some cake. Elder Smith and his dear wife had a nerve to feed me some like awesome cake, and it was such a blessing to my life. Hint, hint, hint. Elder Smith, you could bless your sister with one of them cakes all the way from Alabama. I think it was Alabama you got it from. Charleston, Chattanooga. I don't think it was Alabama. I think it was Chattanooga. But anyway, that cake was so good. I make me a drive to Chattahoochee, Chattanooga for that cake. It was so good. Okay, so you in Tuscaloosa. All right, I don't exactly know where that is, but I know God is there. Amen. Praise the Lord. You could tell the people in Tuscaloosa, calm down. God is here. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, it seems like we have quite a few people who are blessed, and God is using you in your different regions to be a blessing to his people by being prayerful for them, being prayerful for the saints everywhere. And so we're here each and every Thursday and on Sundays at 6:30 p.m. to stand with you in agreement as you get equipped, as you get strong, as you develop in God, to cover you, to cover your families in the name of Jesus. Everything that is going on, we call on the name of the Lord. As a matter of fact, let's just go ahead and pray. Father, we thank you today, Lord, for your riches. We thank you that you're rich in mercy. We thank you, Lord God, that you're rich and abundant in grace. And so we give you the praise, we give you the honor, we give you the glory. Father, I thank you right now in the name of Jesus for the oil that pours down from the head all the way down to the beard, oh God, and even drips into the body on tonight. Father, I thank you that my cup runs over tonight. Thank you, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, for saturating us, Lord, with your anointing, because it's the anointing that destroys the yoke. Father, we thank you right now. We thank you for feeding us. Feed us some more, God. We come thirsty. We come asking you to feed us. We come asking you to feed our thirsty souls, our weary souls, our souls that need restoration, our souls that need deliverance, our soul that needs wisdom from the Almighty God. So many things that are happening, changes that are happening around us. But Father, we look to you because the heart of the king is in God's hands, and people are making decisions with our names attached. People are making decisions, Lord God, with our names attached, oh God, but you are the sovereign God. You're the holy king. You're the one that holds our future. You're the one that causes our steps, Lord God, to manifest. And we thank you today, Lord God, as we look to you. We look to you and we ask you for a downpour. We ask you, Lord God, for fresh oil. We ask you for fresh vision and new insight. We thank you, Lord God, for a sharper discerner. We thank you that you will turn the lights on in dark places, oh God, in the name of Jesus, and that you would reveal the secrets of men's hearts. Hallelujah. For the good and for evil. In Jesus' name, we thank you today. We praise you today. We glorify you today. These are your people, and you know what they stand in need of. God, cover them. Cover them. I cover them under the blood. Under the blood that prevails, the blood that heals, the blood that protects, hallelujah, in the name of Jesus, the blood that makes whole. Father, thank you that your people are covered tonight under the rich, sanctifying blood of Jesus Christ, hallelujah, from the crown of their head to the sole of their feet. And Father, we thank you, Lord God. We rebuke you, Satan. Come on, if you haven't rebuked Satan out loud with your mouth, hallelujah, I need you in your car, in your kitchen, in your living room, at the dining room table, in the bedroom, wherever you are, just say, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus, in the authority that he is giving you to rebuke him. Glory to God. In Jesus' name, I rebuke you out of my family, out of my finances, out of my job, out of my body, out of my relationships, away from my children. Come on, rebuke, rebuke, rebuke. I draw a line. I use my authority. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus, the name that is above every name. Hallelujah. That every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ, He is Lord. He is Lord. He is Lord. Come on, out of my sleep. Come on, come on. Somebody who's struggling with issues in their stomach, in the name of Jesus, the healing power of God is with us, and we rebuke that in Jesus' name. There's somebody that is watching. You got a pain in your stomach. It's not gas. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And I give your name the praise, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. That discomfort is being removed in Jesus' name. Just cause it, Lord God, to disintegrate. Father, thank you right now for it easing. Thank you right now for the pain easing. Thank you that the pain is leaving in Jesus' name. No bondage, no stress. Glory to the name of our God. Come on, God is a healer. He's a healer. He's a healer. And if you agree with that prayer, I want you to put amen. And I want you to put I have victory. Mm-hmm. I have victory. Yes. Go ahead and tag somebody. Go ahead and share with a friend. Go ahead and share. It's a few things that are coming up in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. It's a few things that are coming up. And I do want to alert you that we have 12 days of fasting coming up. Elder Smith and his wife wasn't able to join us during Summer Love. And so I'm going to ask them to come and share with us during the 12 days of fasting. I have a few other prophets and ministers of the Lord that will join us on this 12 days. Mark your calendar. It's the 20th, October 20th through the 31st. Mm-hmm. October the 20th through the 31st. It is time for us to see a change in our lives and our families and our communities. It is time. And God says this is time to restore. Joel, when in the book of Joel, when the people sought the Lord, this was the Lord's response. Joel 2:25, and I will restore to you the years that the locusts have eaten, and the cankerworm, and the caterpillar, and the palmer worm are my great army, which I sent among you. Praise God. God is going to restore. He is going to restore. He's going to restore all of the things that those words represent to you. Some of you all lost a job during the pandemic. Some of you all lost a marriage during the pandemic. Some of you all lost loved ones due to COVID-19. But God is a God that will bring restoration of your faith. Some of you all are in a place of wavering back and forward. You're wavering. You're in a dilemma. Some of you all are tired. Some of you all are in dry places. You're in the valley. You're in the valley of decision. You're in the valley of fighting. You're in a valley of God taking you through a transition. You're in a valley of being tested. You're in a valley. Hallelujah. Glory to God. But God is going to restore, just as sure as my name is Natasha Nicole Davis. My God is going to restore you. And so for those 12 days, we have some people who are gearing up to fast and to consecrate. So what is the fast? What is the consecration? No meats, no sweets. And we're going to pray every day at 7:00 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, even if you have to catch the replay. But for those 12 days, we are going to pray. We're going to pray, we're going to gather together, and we're going to pray. So this announcement will be available on my Facebook page after the broadcast on tonight. Tag somebody and let them know that we are inviting them to come on a journey of petitioning the Lord, a journey of claiming what God has in store for us, a time of prophesying, it's time to use your mouth. If you don't know, it's time to use your mouth. If you don't know, it is time for you to employ your mouth. The Bible declares that life and death is in the power of your tongue. So even when you don't feel like you're on the mountaintop, even though you are seeing things manifest before you that do not look like the promises of God, He said that you could use your mouth. He say unto this mountain, be removed. there were so many things. He says that the tongue is a small member that boasts great things. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And we're going to eat the fruit of the things that we confess, the things that we believe. So a lot of things that's going on around us, but I'm going to keep my mouth activated in God's holy word. And the Bible says that faith comes by hearing. When your mouth is moving, when your mouth is employed by saying, what God says and reciting his word and standing on his word, then he will not ignore his word. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God, and he will not allow his word to be returned unto him void. And so we are going to prevail into fasting and into praying. Those of you who know me know that I stand on Joel 2 and 18. Whenever I fast and pray, God bless you. Good to have you, Brother Devin. When I fast and pray, I stand on that scripture because the Bible says that he answers. He replied. Huh? When you fast the right way, he responds. You can't make him do nothing. When you fall in alignment with what God has said and you do it the way he says to do it, then he will respond. So you get ready to have a response. You get ready to have your strength renewed. Get ready to hear from God. Get ready for doors to open. Get ready. He said, I'm going to restore. When God speaks, in this particular, I'm not going to preach tonight. That's not my assignment to preach what the 12 days of fasting will represent. But I just love the book of Joel because I believe it represents truly when people come together in obedience to God. God calls a fast. He calls a fast. And when we are in a place of exhortation, that's what it means for us to gather to receive, gather to receive. But you read the book of Joel in your own time, and you will see that the Lord said, the Bible says that the Lord replied to the people's fast. And he just didn't reply with a word. He just didn't say something verbally. The Bible says that he restored grain. The Bible says that he sent everything that they needed. They had water. They had food. They had been in a famine. Glory to God. I can't wait. Restoration, 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 restoration. So restoration is coming to your house. It's coming to your marriage. It's coming to your relationship with your children. And there are some things that you haven't felt in a long time. Hallelujah. And it's coming, it's coming, it's coming, it's coming, it's coming. I dare you to put some sticky notes around your house saying, it's coming. Restoration is coming. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise the Lord. Glory to God. So we have my birthday on the calendar for the 22nd of September. Next month is our consecration month. We're consecrating 12 days. Thank you, Jesus. And so I do really want you to mark your calendars for those things. Yes, it's coming, it's coming, it's coming. It's coming, it's coming, it's coming. I'm coming into my new decade. I'm coming into my new decade and some things that my mom didn't walk in, but I'm walking in it. Hallelujah. I'm going to receive hers and mine. Praise God. Hallelujah. I'm receiving it for what God has appointed for my life. Just a small and brief recap for those of you who hadn't been with us on last week. I made an introduction. An introduction was made to you on today is Thursday. So Sunday I made an introduction to you about training. And let me just say this: you got to have a bulldog mentality when it comes to the things that God has promised you. You have to have a bulldog mentality when it comes to the things that God has promised you. It's not that the promises don't belong to you or they're out of reach. It's not that. It's just that you have to be firmly planted in the word of God. You gotta be firmly planted. You gotta be convinced. The kingdom of heaven suffer violence and the violent take it by force. Sometimes you have to just be in a place to where you are looking to have a stubborn countenance when it comes to your faith being tried, when it comes to your family being attacked, when it comes to, you know, a door is open, but you don't see the manifestation of what's promised, you have to be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. You have to always be steadfast in what God has promised, because he's not a man that he should lie. Come on here. Read your Bible. Numbers 23 talks about God not being a liar. For the times that God has restored, I'm very excited. I'm going to be the whole time, I'm going to be walking in the spirit without an umbrella, because I want to get wet in every place of my life. I want to bring to your attention the book of Daniel. I may not stay in Daniel very long today, but that is the foundation scripture that we talked about, just to catch those of you up who wasn't with us on Sunday. This is session number 2. You can go to my Facebook page, Natasha Ann Davis, search Natasha Ann Davis, and you will be able to see last week's message, last week's first session on training. Training a service protocol. There are some things that are happening in the spirit realm. There are some positions that are moving. I believe that is a natural reaction to some things that are moving in the spirit. That there has been an increase of unemployment, not because jobs have not been available, but people are simply getting in their rightful places. They're coming from being employees to business owners. They're changing careers. And I don't believe that's a government initiation. I believe that is something that has been ushered, a door that has been opened through this pandemic. Why? Because God said that he will work all things together for the good of them that love God and the called according to his purpose, that he's going to work it together for your good. So I believe some shifting is taking place in the kingdom of God, and people are finding their rightful place. So as I begin to talk to you on today, I do want to make some notes and give those who hadn't been with us. I want to do like a brief recap, and then I want to go ahead and jump in to where we are in session number 2. If you get your Bibles out and your notes and your instruments to write with your journal, you will find that from our session on Sunday that we talked about Daniel and the divine training that God had taken him through. We had things that we highlighted that Daniel was selected in Babylon. He was selected. He's selected. So we're speaking that over you in the name of Jesus, that in this season you will be selected. He was selected for service. He was selected for service, even though he was taken from Judah, even though he was taken from his homeland, and he was taken from his homeland because there was an invasion, and there is a little bit of history that we don't have time to catch up for in this session, but because of the disobedience of some things that King Hezekiah allowed, Judah was taken captive. And Nebuchadnezzar was the king of Babylon at that time. And the king gave some very strategic instructions to his chief officer. He gave him some specific instructor. He said, I'm looking for some new people. He says, I'm looking for some new people to serve in the royal kingdom, in the royal service. He said, I'm looking for some new people. And he says, I have a protocol that I want you to select from. There is a protocol. There is an outline. There is a set of instructions. There are some characteristics that I'm looking for in these new people. He says, so in your selection, he says, I want you to select those that are strong. I want you to select from among them those that are strong and healthy and good looking men. Read your Bible. That's what the Bible says in the New Living Translation. And he says that those that are well versed in every branch of learning. And Daniel found himself in the midst of the people who was selected. He was selected for a royal training. And so you could put yourself in the midst of that text, or drop yourself in the text, and you can say, I was, Natasha was, I am selected for royal service. And so the Bible records that he says those that are gifted with knowledge and sound judgment. And so if you find yourself in a place where you feel like those things are missing from you, good news for you on tonight. That is a gift that God will grant and give you. All you got to do is ask him for it. And so the Bible says that these were people that the king was looking for. He was looking for some knowledgeable people. He was looking for some people with good judgment. I want you to go ahead and tag your friends. Even though I'm at a place right now where I'm doing a brief recap, we are about to, God bless you, cousin. How you doing? Sister Tashiel, buckle your seatbelts, because we're going to go in a little bit. Go ahead and tag a friend. So listen, so the Bible says that the king had a selection process. He had a selection process. He says those that are suited to serve in the royal palace has these attributes, right? And so you read your Bible in Daniel chapter number 1 all the way down to the very end of the chapter. You'll see where the king heavily relied on his servants. He heavily relied on his servants. And so that's why they had to be that's why they had to have the characteristics, because the king, he heavily relied on, God only selects people that he can rely on. Jesus selected his 12 disciples because they are reliable. He trained them, but the foundation and at the core, there was a protocol or a standard that he was looking for. God bless you in the Bahamas on tonight, Sister Justina. There was a protocol that he was looking for. There was a protocol that Jesus was looking for. We talked about training was of the essence. So the Bible talks about God giving Daniel unusual aptitude and learning. And so for those of you all who are struggling in school, you're struggling on your job, you're struggling to gain a place of expertise, you're straining to get in a place to where you are skilled and that you're master in a place of mastering your gifts, your talents, and even in your secular career, you're in that place. I want you to pray Daniel 1:17. Why? Because every time that I've been in a scholarly place, or every time I've been in a place where I had to take a test or take a course, which I'll be back among the ranks of those who in continuing education really soon. And so one of the things when I find it very difficult for me to get an understanding or for me to gain a discipline, I always pray Daniel 1:17, but I pray it from the New Living Translation. And it says this: God gave these four young men an unusual aptitude for understanding every aspect of literature and wisdom. It could be your company's manual. It could be math 101. It could be chemistry. It could be algebra. It could be statistics. It could be language. It can be anything. It'd be arts, it could be history, it could be anything. But the Bible says that God gave them unusual aptitude. That's a prayer to pray right now. Lord, I thank you for unusual aptitude. In every aspect of literature and wisdom. How many times have you read something and you still didn't get the instructions? You looked at the pictures, you read the words, it came in every nationality, it came in every tongue, and no matter what it was you were trying to comprehend, you just didn't get it. You need to pray this prayer. And God gave Daniel the special ability to interpret the meanings of visions and dreams. Now, every leader is looking for a person that has good judgment, that has insight, that has understanding, that has revelation, that represents him or her in the capacity that would advance them and cause them less stress. Every leader, every pastor, every assistant pastor, every first assistant, every lead elder, every deacon, every supervisor, manager, VP, every department head, every regional manager, every person is looking for a person or people on their staff that have these qualities. Pay attention. So the Bible talks about Daniel and his friends being selected. So this was the royal service. This was the royal service. Just think about that for a moment, that your royal service or your service in the kingdom of God is for you to be a person that is seated wherever you are with the mastery of judgment, that you're not the person that pop off. You're not the person that acts irresponsible. You're not the person who slights your responsibilities. You are the person who your leadership is looking for. And so as I pick up on this week or on this particular session too, as I would continue to pray, I want you to know that Daniel's skill set was soon put to test. Because King Nebuchadnezzar had a very disturbing dream, is what the Bible says in chapters 1 and 2. And those on the king's staff that was not able to interpret or to give him the dream, number one, he had to give them the dream. And he had to, you know, as a servant, you had to tell the king what his dream was. It was no clues or hints. Tell us what the dream, you got to tell me what the dream is, and then you have to rightfully and rightly interpret the dream. And so these are the reasons why we are in the master's service, to answer difficult things that are going on in the earth realm. We are a people who are being trained for service. We're being trained for service. A biblical example that that God brought me through when I was studying this is given to me in the book of Samuel. In the book of Samuel, if you want to go over to 1 Samuel chapter number 3, if you want to make a note of it, you can go ahead and make a note of it. But the Bible says in Daniel 3 and 7, 1 Samuel 3 and 3, where Samuel, as a child, he wasn't having a dream, but he was having an experience where God was calling him, and he was not trained. He was not yet trained to know that it was the voice of God. I want you to pay attention, and I want you to lean into what the Holy Spirit is saying to you directly. He was a novice. He had not come to a place of hearing the Lord's voice. All of us are at a place, either in our youth and our relationship with God, or you're in the foundation years of your career, and you don't quite know how things are to go. And the Bible says that Eli In verse number 4, suddenly the Lord called out Samuel. Yes, Samuel replied, what is it? And he got up and he went to Eli and he said, here am I. He said, did you call me? He said, I didn't call you, Eli replied. Go back to bed. So he did. And then the Lord called out Samuel. And again, Samuel got up and went to Eli. He said, here I am. Did you call me? And then Eli responded and said, I didn't call you. Go back to bed. Verse 7 says, Samuel did not yet know the Lord's voice because he had never heard the message from the Lord before. So those of you that are looking at this video or watching this live broadcast or maybe the replay, and you're at a place to where you're saying, I don't know that if I hear the Lord's voice or if I know the Lord's voice, or how do I know when I receive a response or a message from the Lord? Listen and pay attention. So the Lord called a third time once more, and Samuel got up and went to Eli, and he said to him, here I am. Did you call me? Then it lets me know that Samuel really was hearing. He was hearing clearly. He just didn't know the source of his hearing. And then Eli realized that it was the Lord who was calling the boy. That for Eli, he had to come to a place of recognizing, here's this little child. Maybe he didn't get it the first two times because Samuel was a little boy. And so Eli realized that the Lord was calling the boy. So he said in verse 9, so he says, Samuel, go and lie down again. And if someone calls you, because y'all say, something told me, right? You say, and something told me. And he says, and if someone calls again, he says, say, speak, Lord, your servant is listening. Now, in this translation, there is a distinct in saying, speak, Lord, your servant is listening. Why wouldn't Eli say to him, respond, speak, Lord, Samuel is listening? Why wouldn't he say or tell him to respond, speak, Lord, your son is listening? Why was the terminology, your servant is listening? And so Samuel went back to bed, and the Lord came and called as before, Samuel, Samuel. And Samuel replied, speak, Lord, your servant is listening. The Lord will call you as his servant, a royal service, because the Lord's service requires characteristics. In his innocence as a young child, Samuel had not learned to be a liar. He hadn't learned to be a person that would distort, if you will. He hadn't learned any of the things that would pollute his source of being a messenger. And then the Lord said to Samuel, I'm about to do a shocking thing in Israel. Here it is that the Lord calls Samuel, but he calls Samuel with the importance of being able to trust him. Listen, to be able to trust him with a very important message. I want to talk to you tonight or today, whenever you might see this, is that the reason for your service, the reason for your training is to carry out very valuable service to God, to the kingdom of God, which is the Lord's people. Even in your secular career, there has to be a distinction on you as a believer. It has to be a distinction on you as a believer that you have to have a protocol in your characteristics for a leader to be able to trust you. I want to talk about that for just a moment in session two, because the Lord's service requires someone who is dedicated. So if you don't remember, Samuel's mom was Hannah, who was barren for 10 years. And then the Lord, she made a covenant with God and the Lord remembered her and she brought forth Samuel. And she brought forth Samuel with a condition or a contract to the Lord that she would leave him in the house of God, that she would leave him in the temple so that the priest could raise him as the Lord's servant. So Samuel understood that he was there and that was his lifestyle. Come on, pay attention. That was his lifestyle. His lifestyle was to be a trusted servant. Whatever he saw in the temple, whatever he saw in, well, if you are serving a king like Daniel, you have to have this protocol because you're going to see things in the temple. You're going to hear things in the temple and the kingdom around the king's throne. You are going to hear conversations. You are going to witness agreements, and you're going to be in a place to where information will be at your disposal. But you got to be in a place to where you are a consecrated vessel that can be trusted. So Samuel knew that he was consecrated, right? And he was learning, he was finding out what his consecration was. So I want to tell you on tonight, if you're writing any kind of notes, in session two, I want to tell you that there are two types of training. Just very basically, two types of training. There is an ideal training, There's an ideal training, and then there is a practical training, right? So Daniel was trained to speak to great people. He was trained to speak to great people. If you go back and read Daniel chapter number one and chapter number two, you will see that he had a background, that he was already serving in the palace. He was already serving his leader in Judah. He was already serving his leader. And so he needed to have a training that was suitable for him to be around a new leader. So he was trained to be in leadership. So the ideal part of the training is that you want to be trained to the degree that you know how to speak to VPs, you know how to speak to managers, you know how to speak to team leads. If you're a person that's not necessarily a title holding person, right? If you're not a title holding person, that's an ideal thing that you want to do. You want to be able to speak to lead servants and the chief of staff, because Daniel did, right? He spoke to the king. So the king, he expects people around him to tell the truth. And he does have some discernment of if you're speaking to him the truth or not. That's why he told the enchanters, the magicians, the astrologers, he said, hey, if you don't give me the right interpretation of this, then I'm going to tear you from limb to limb. So you must realize that the ideal place of your training has to be to a place to where you're trained to be trusted. You're trained to be trusted. Come on, let's talk about trusted training. If you're a doctor, if you're a hygienist, you are trained to be trusted, and you need to have a trust as a part of your training, because you can't look in people's mouths as a dentist and then lie and say, I have cavities and I don't have cavities, but you want to charge me all this money. So you're going to make up something. Come on. We see it in public. And we see it in our secular lives and our day-to-day goings. We see that. We see that. And so you want to have a protocol and a posture in service that is trustworthy, right? So you're not out here trying to take advantage of the Lord's people. You're not out here trying to take advantage of your people who are patronizing your business, right? So ideally, you want to be trained, and you want to have a process in which you are trusted to give service. So he was, let me talk about who he was a little bit. You know, he was open and vulnerable with his friends. So in all of your training, you got to be open, you got to be vulnerable. I love the fact that I have a physician that will say to me, okay, let me tell you this. Let me talk to you. You don't have to take medication for this. You can change your diet. You can exercise. You know, I love to have physicians that say, you know, they don't have to slap medication on you for everything. Or they will say to you, in my experience, let me tell you what has been the case. So this is somebody who I trust. They're giving you information that they don't have to give you. But because they are honorable people and they have a training for a service protocol, they are open and they're vulnerable. And I love it because my doctor began to talk to me about her personal experiences. My physician is a believer. My physician is a believer, and she begins to tell me and talk to me about her personal experiences so that I can trust her and so that I can also gauge to see if there was any treatment or practices or anything that I want to take on. I do it having a vulnerability in the relationship that I have with my physician. So she's able to be vulnerable with me. She's a very good physician. And so here it is, the king. The king staff people around him because they are going to see him at every angle. They're going to see the king sick. They're going to see him in love. They're going to, at this point, they're going to see him, you know, exercising, you know, he's in fear. He was having a dream and he was in fear. He was not in the midst of the people of the kingdom. He wasn't in around the villagers or the people who lived in the kingdom. He was among his servants. And let me remind you that Jesus put himself in the same place. He said, I don't call you servants anymore. I call you friends. The disciples was around Jesus at every phase of his life. And they saw him. And three in particular, he would invite when he was having a hard time. Peter, James, and John. Peter, James, and John saw Jesus at his most vulnerable and frustrated times in life. And so when you talk about having a training protocol, I want to stop you. I want to pause. And I thank God for Jesus and the teaching of this lesson, because a lot of people, you want the rank, but you don't understand what comes with the rank. You want the position, but you don't understand what comes with the position. It is very honorable for you to serve a king. It is very honorable for you to serve a pastor, to serve a prophet, to serve a minister, to serve as a minister, to serve as an elder. It is very honorable for you. Why? Because you get to see not only from a leadership perspective, you get to see your pastor stressed. You get to see your pastor possibly having marital issues and spats. You get to see your pastor probably concerned and moved because the budget is not right. You get to see your manager in a place of frustration because now he or she is responsible for all of the stuff that's been stolen out of the warehouse. How could you let this happen? Because their leaders are going to be on top of them about, okay, so how did you let this happen? How did you let this happen? How did you let this thievery take place? Who did you trust? And so it is an insult when there are ungodly things that are happening or things that are people who can't be trusted. It's an insult because the king is like, so now who do I need to kill? Do I need to downsize? Because the king is like, how treacherous is my staff to be in cohorts with people who would try to kill me or make me look bad? Which brings me to Nehemiah. Nehemiah was a trusted cupbearer. You get it? In your spare time, go and study Nehemiah. Let me run over there right quick. Nehemiah, I'm just going to drop in chapter number one. Nehemiah 1. Well, maybe let's go over to chapter number two, right? Okay. So, Baba says in verse number 2, wherefore the king said unto me, why is thy countenance sad, seeing thou art not sick? This is nothing else but sorrow of heart. And then I was very sore and afraid and said unto the king, let the king live forever. Why should my countenance be sad when the city, the place of my father's sepulchres lieth waste, which means that, you know, it was in ruin. The part that I wanted to get to was that he was in the king's presence all the time. And the Bible said that he was the one that guarded the king's wine and that he was a person that he was to guard and to defend everything that the king was to eat. So he was heavily relied upon. So being in the king's company, you weren't supposed to have a sad disposition. You weren't supposed to be a negative in the king's presence. So when you're selected to be around people, leaders don't want negative energy around them. That's why they said select the people who are good looking, healthy, and strong. They don't want people who are around them that are whiners and crybabies. They only want to have people around them that could bring a positive, healthy disposition to the team and to the table. And if that's you, that's the crybaby and the whiner, I need you to leave this session in prayer and in confession that you are in training for the Lord's service, that you're in training for the Lord's service, and that the protocol of your training is about to be activated. So Jesus was trained to trust his Father, because everything that Jesus walked out, he walked out because of his love and trust for the Father, for God the Father, right? So you got to be in a place, the king is at a place to where he's vulnerable, so he has to have some trained and trusted people around him, right? So Daniel, when he was in trouble, the king had said to Daniel, and he said, hey, if y'all can't tell me what my dream is and interpret it, then you're going to die. So Daniel came as the leader to his friends, and Daniel conveyed the king's heart to Meshach and Abednego. He told them, he says, listen, I'm very concerned because we have to interpret this king's dream, and he's already killed the guys who are the astrologers and the magicians. He's already killed them. And if we don't pray and seek the face of the Lord, he's going to kill us too. So we need to pray. We need to pray. I doubt it very seriously if he came back to the room all calm. The Bible says that the three of them, they went into prayer, or the four of them rather, they went into prayer, and God revealed the secret. You cannot live a life now. We are on, you know, we get a chance to be in church. We get a chance to get on some live streams. We get a chance to see videos in different media outlets. But listen, let me be very honest and upfront with you. The life of servants, or the life of service, is not the totality of you going to a restaurant, you telling your server that you didn't like your salad, and that's the conclusion of it. Because the servant has to be strong enough, the server, the bartender, the whoever it is that took your order, they have to look at you, the barista at Starbucks, they have to look at you and they have to be strong enough to receive that you didn't like what it is that they gave you or what was being served to you. If you get a good servant, they got to be strong enough that they don't take it personal that your steak wasn't cooked to perfection. They can't take it personal that the sweet tea don't really taste all of that good. Listen, you have to be in a place to, when you're saying you're called to service, Your pastor don't need you having no thin, weak, ready to fight, ready to quit mentality when something that he or she sees that is not of his liking. If you are a servant, then you should be groomed, bringing expertise. You have to be groomed with an expertise. You have to be able to intelligently articulate what is needed. You listen. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Let's talk about the 12 spies, right? The 12 spies went and saw something and they were trained. Now, there were 10 that were intimidated, but the Bible says that Joshua and Caleb had a different spirit. They came back saying, oh, we're well able to overtake them. But the other 10 was intimidated. I'm asking you today, what kind of servant are you? What kind of training have you had from God? What kind of training have you had from the other people around you, whether it's in ministry or on your team? It's some team members I look at and it's like, never mind, I will ask another source, because they are nonchalant or they want to give you the shortcut. They want to give you something that's not going to necessarily cause the leadership to be pleased. And a lot of times people in leadership roles, not all of them, some of them, they are hired straight out of college and they have never graduated through the ranks. So they don't really know what your role is other than your HR description, right? But they don't really know what your workload is like. So you got to bring an articulate, very descriptive voice and a posture that will cause them to listen and get a very visual experience from you. But most of the times we don't stand up or not able to stand up and speak during the presentation or speak during the team meeting because we're not articulate enough. We're not confident. Training brings confidence. So we're talking about idealistic training. Idealistic training will bring you confidence. I got my certificate. I got my degree in my hand. I have passed the teaching. I have my teaching certification, which means I went to college, which means I'm able to pass my state's certification that makes me a teacher. Listen, when you have training, you do have a confidence about you. You have confidence about you. I already know that people are not trained. When I'm at the altar doing deliverance ministry, and those of you that have been, you know, anywhere that I am, I'm an altar preacher. I believe in the ministry of laying hands. I believe in prophecy. I believe in laboring. I believe in being on the floor with you. I believe in, and if you're a person that want to be free, or if you're a person that you've asked God to come in, I'm with you for the long haul, right? I'm with you. People who don't want to be free, people who don't want God, not thirsty, I'm not wasting my time, right? That's practical. I'm not. But when you work around deliverance and you scared to touch the people, or you doing too much, I go in places sometimes and it's not a hit on them, but you are an obstruction to the deliverance that's about to take place, or we're desiring to take place, because simply you are not trained. You all over the person. I can't pray for the person and touch them because you are all over them. But those of us who are trained and of a mature, you know, nature, we know how to smile at you and say, she all right. You know, back up. It's okay. Without having a nasty disposition and breaking the people or hurting the people who's only trying to help. So I'm not saying that you shouldn't try to help. I'm saying the best service is a trained service. So there are plenty of books out there that's available, especially when it comes to where I talked about being a cupbearer as a person that is necessary, that is a protector, somebody who is an armor bearer that is protected. Another person who is a son or a daughter has like practical training. So if you're an armor bearer, yes, you can go to a class. Yes, you can read a book. But there is no ideal training, so to speak, where you could go to Armor Bearer Academy and become a certified armor bearer. Nurses do that. Teachers do that, right? You get this ideal, which is ideal when you have a profession, right? Some pastors even go to seminary, but you know, I can't give you a calling as a pastor. That's something that has to come from God, even though you might have biblical education, right? You might learn how there are people who are not even Christians that have a great theological foundation. There are so many other beliefs that can talk to you about the Bible better than Christians can talk about the Bible, because they have truly, ideally studied the Bible because of world religion and all these different things. And so they can talk to you. God bless you, Andrea Willis. Thank you so very much for joining on the God. Listen, the Lord bless your business and your family owners that are business owners as well, in Jesus' name. Listen, and that was for Andrea Willis, in Jesus' name. Listen. So when we talk about practical training is training that is caught, is not taught. Practical training is what you got when you was around Jesus a lot. You caught that he was a praying man. You caught that he was a discerner. You caught that prophecy flowed through him. You caught those things. That's not something that Jesus was teaching on. He wasn't teaching them prophecy. You didn't get teaching about prophecy until you got to Paul talking about speaking in tongues and judging correctly. And he wrote 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians as a model and a tool for how the gifts of the Spirit are supposed to flow and operate in the church so that there will be no chaos or no dysfunction. Paul said, I need you to get some training. He said, I need you to have some practical training so everybody won't be around here speaking in tongues saying the Lord said, the Lord said. And so Paul begins to give them practical teaching, like when you pray in tongues, it only builds you up. It only edifies you as the person who is doing the speaking. You are building yourself up. Now, when you have the gift of interpretation and a tongue is released in the atmosphere, then you can release the interpretation and everybody who is listening can get built up because everybody is in understanding. That is what you call practical training. I can't teach you to interpret tongues. That's something between you and the Holy Ghost. I can't teach you. I can't give you a frequency that you hear God on. But Eli gave Samuel a practical model to use that the next time you hear, because I'm not calling you son, the next time you hear, then he's familiar with the things of God. The next time you hear, you become a watchman of deliverance ministers. You become a watchman of your pastor. You become a watchman to your supervisor, to your manager, and you will get on a frequency with them, and there is an expectation. So you know the way God uses the woman of God or the man of God who you serve, you can pretty much tap into, oh God, I need a I need, come on, she's about to fall. You know, she's about to fall. If you're following me, anything might happen. I might clap my hands and the person, you know, get filled with the Spirit or the power of God might come over them. Anything might happen. I might touch one person on the shoulder and a whole row go down. It's some things that you just can't be prepared for, but there are some things that you can pretty much anticipate. There are some things that you can anticipate. So formal training is pretty much ideal. It's legal, right? There are some things you got to do every year. Like those of you who sell insurance, you might have to renew your license every year. Those of you who are in business, you might have to renew your license every year. You might have to take a recertification every so many years. If you do anything like that, you have to have a legal ideal training process. That's why when you go in most businesses, they have a frame around their business license, because they want you to know that they are legitimate, right? That they are reputable. They are a reputable establishment, right? Natasha Davis Ministries is a reputable establishment. I pay taxes. I pay the renewal fees to my business license every year. Listen, it is a functioning, reputable, legal entity. So when you talk about having business, you know, more formal training is you going on a course, that you have a course. There is a course, there is a syllabus that is ideal, that is formal training, right? And you need it to have structure. You need it to have structure. When there is no practical or formal training, there is chaos. When there is no formal training, you gotta have some disclosure agreements. Okay. When you have formal training, there are some disclosure agreements. There is organization. There are principles and there are protocols that have to be in place when you have training. When you don't have training, anything goes. It's chaotic. It's a free for all. Right? When you're in a daycare and you're doing stuff to people's kids, man, you about to get closed down, because there are some laws that are in place for you as a daycare provider. As you're a preschool teacher, they give a background check. You have to be, you know, they go up one side and come down another side because they have to protect people. When there's formal training, you have to have, sometimes it's required for you to have insurance. You're a building inspector, you're a contractor. All of that is, you have to be certified HVAC person. You got to be certified. Sometimes you got to be bonded. Sometimes you have to have insurance. All of that you have to have. And it is formal. So those of you that you got your mobile tattoo business, I'm going to say to you, is you out here doing this stuff illegal without a business license, without insurance, without knowing the laws and knowing what to do in case of an emergency and all that stuff, I'm saying you're taking a very big risk. And you're not trustworthy. You out here, you know, doing hair and doing this and doing that, you know, and doing the other. You doing lashes, you microblading, you doing all that kind of stuff without proper certification and without formal training. You might be gifted and you might be talented, but you are out of order doing it without having a formal source of training, because the person who you are giving the business to, they deserve to have a backup if something were to happen. That's why physicians, they have big insurance policies, because in the event that you make an error or make a mistake, then that person's family is going to want you to pay for what you did, and they want a big explanation. So when we're talking about practical things that are caught and not taught, I'm talking about a grace. I might have a grace. I might have a grace. And a lot of times we're behind where we are because you haven't caught what you need to catch from someone and you haven't identified what that grace is. I can't teach you to break an atmosphere. You just got to be around me. And then there is a grace that comes on you from being around me while I'm doing it. Right? There is no training class I could give you about that. There's no training class to give you about having apostolic presence. There's no training class that I could give you about that. You have to be around and in, or your relationship with God. There is no training class that I could teach you how to pray 2, 3, 4, 5 hours. That's a grace that comes upon you. That is a grace that comes upon you. It's a grace that comes upon you from God, right? It's a demonstration that comes upon you from God. And when the disciples could not, when the disciples could not cast out a devil, the only thing Jesus told them was, he said, this kind requires training. This kind, you got to go fast and you got to have to go pray. And it is techniques and strengths and undoings. There are some things that him saying to them, a method. He gave them a method of effectiveness. He gave them a method. He said, go fast and go pray. And the fasting and the praying, he says, the Bible says in Isaiah 58, that when we fast and pray, we undo heavy burdens, right? We loose the bands of wickedness. Now, it would take the Holy Ghost to show you and to give you some practical steps on how to do some things in the atmosphere where there are bands of wickedness, you know, where there are burdens that you can't physically see with the natural eye, right? So Sister Willis says, even carrying concealed weapons license, you have to be trained and recertified. Very good point. Very good point. You have to be retrained and recertified, you know, especially now as gun laws are changing. Gun laws are changing. And so I want you to know that Jesus had both. He had a formal training, right? He had a formal training. And then he had a practical training. He was called rabbi at the age of 30, which is the age that once you've had Hebrew training and once you have sat and learned the Pentateuch, which is the Old Testament, when you've sat and learned and become how are you going to become a reputable person? And we don't ever see you in certain places at the same time whenever the training is. How are you going to become a respected stylist or a respected musician or a respected person, and there is no notoriety? You know, by the time you get world renowned in anything, you have put in the time, and there has been a fame or a popularity associated with your dedication, that now your name speaks for you. So Jesus had both. He had a formal training and he had a practical training. Paul had a formal training, but he had to go gangster when it can't come to his practical, because he didn't spend time at the feet of Jesus physically like the other disciples. So when you read on Paul, you read that he was the Hebrew of Hebrews. You read that he was a good-looking Jew. You read that, you know, he had came from a good background and good family, had, you know, so much education, right? He was elite. He was a very elite person in his training. But that apostolic and devil casting and his handkerchiefs and all of that being anointed, that was off the cuff right there. That was practical training that he got from, number one, being around the other disciples, having a relationship with God, you know, his experiences, the trainings that the Bible says that he was shipwrecked, he had been imprisoned, shipwrecked, you know, that he had been attacked. There was a lot of things that Paul went through for practical training that caused the gifts of God to emerge in his life. So listen to me in this session too, with Daniel chapters 1 and 2 as your base. I want to tell you that your training is necessary. Your training is necessary. There's an awesome book that I have here by Terry Nance. It's called God's Armor Bearer. Even though you may not be an armor bearer, but you're in the King's service, or you're in kingdom service, or maybe you are a leader, or you stand with a leader, I want to encourage you to get this book. I want to encourage you to get this book. It's called God's Armor Bearer, Volumes 1 and 2. A lot of people think that the armor bearer ministry is for you to carry somebody's Bible and for you to get their water and stuff like that. It's more, way more stuff than that. And this is not an armor bearer service training class. So I'm not going to go through what an armor bearer is. I did get some helpful. It tell you some basic, you know, duties and stuff like that. I got some powerful nuggets out of that book. Make sure you get volumes 1 and 2 because I had to go back and get the second edition when it was revised. Okay. But when you are in leadership and you are around great people, there are just so many other things that you have to be up on. You have to catch, you have to pay attention, you have to have a clean heart. You can't be messy in any leadership capacity. If you're not a respected leader, then you're probably messy. You probably gossip. People probably know you gossip. You know, you're talking about people, you have a bad reputation, you steal, you don't show up on time. You know, all this kind of stuff. There's so many things that the Lord wanted me to share with you just as a tip and a introduction that he trusts people. Let's talk about Joseph. You know, let's talk about Joseph as a person in the kingdom, right? As a person who was close to the king, as a cupbearer. Let's talk about Nehemiah, whose job was to sniff out poison. Can we talk about that? Can we talk about that? That Nehemiah's job was to detect poison. How are you gonna be an armor bearer around me and you can't catch warfare in the air? You're a person that's supposed to carry someone's, not mine, to carry someone's weaponry initially. You can't carry the person's weaponry. You're afraid of their disposition. One of the biggest, it's some people that really get my attention in the Bible, like Elisha, you had to get some thick skin because walking with Elijah, who was like an introvert and powerful and, you know, he had been temperamental, but Elisha walked with him. And when they were trying to talk about, you know, when they were trying to alert, like a company of prophets was trying to alert Elisha that Elijah was about to be taken away because a company of prophets, you know, they catch it in the spirit what's about to happen. And so he shut them down. He said, hold your peace. He said, Elisha. He said, hold your peace. He said, they were trying to tell him, did you know your follower will be taken away from you today? First of all, Elisha checked them. He was like, you're not going to tell me anything about my father that I don't already know. Who are you? You're not walking with my father. You're not walking with this man of God. So I already know. And I already have a prayer request in with the Lord concerning his departure. So he shut him down. So how are you going to have a relationship with someone you serve? And you let just anything come on in your spirit about the person. You know, don't do that. So Paul and Timothy, Joshua and Moses, like I said, Elijah and Elisha, right? You know, there was a connectiveness between them. They walked together. They had a connectiveness between them. And then, as I said, Peter, James, and John was close to Jesus, right? So it's an intentional model of behavior when you get trained to serve. It is intentional behavior. It is intentional behavior when you get trained to serve. When a company pays for you to go away on a retreat or a conference or a convention, when a company pays for you, it's intentional. They have an expectation to trust you with the knowledge that you would receive. It is intentional. when a man or a woman of God have you around them imparting information in you. That's where I'm really going to draw the line, because the time is getting away from us. And so, you know, you just have to, you have to be a person that you have ideal formal training, and then you have to have practical training that is caught and not taught. And that simply comes with an opportunity that somebody gives you. An opportunity that someone gives you to have access to them, right? So for those of you that have ideal training, be humble like Daniel was. Be humble like Daniel was. How he spoke to his brothers, and how he spoke to his friends as brothers. And, you know, there was no big I's and little U's, even though the king primarily talked to him. Be humble. Be humble in your practice, in your formal training. Just because you have a formal training doesn't give you the right to look down on somebody. Hear me, you doctors and PhDs and archbishops and whatever your role is, and whatever it is that you walk in the kingdom. And if you're the regional vice something, I ought to not meet your ego before I meet you. As I said to you, the education arena, God has another assignment for me, my next phase of education. And so the higher I go, there are some people who I'd like to model. There's some people that I like to model that are scholarly people that have formal education, but they are so humble and they are so down to earth. People like Dr. People don't know that he's a doctor, but Pastor John Hanna. Pastor John Hanna in Chicago, he is very educated, but he teaches so practical. Him and Dr. Jamone Glenn together, both of them are very educated. They both have secular and theological education and training at the doctorate level, but they speak intelligently, but they're so humble. And then, of course, there is Dr. Jamal Bryant, which he is addressed by his doctoral accomplishment. But, you know, he will tell you in a minute that he got a GED and a doctorate. That's probably where I'm going to fall at. Got a GED and a doctorate. Very humble, very humble. And so it gives you a security. Your humility ought to give you a security to just be touchable. All right. That was a lot. But before we get ready to go, I want you to type, "I hear you, Lord." That's all I want you to type. "I hear you, Lord. I hear you, Lord." That's what I want you to type, because through these sessions are some things being stirred. Through this session are some ideas coming together. Through these sessions, your personal devotion and study time are gonna come together. "I hear you, Lord." There are some prophets. You need to go back to school. And I'm not talking about get a student loan or go to do anything official. That means, when was the last time that you have registered for the office of the prophet? When the last time you've had your spiritual gifts sharpened? Those of you who teach Sunday school, those of you who you might need to invest in some new tools. I'll be prayerful. I don't know you, Andrew Willis. I don't think we've ever met, but there's something concerning business that God is doing deeper in your life and in your family. There is, whatever this training is, there is an expansion in your business. And I speak the favor of the Lord on you regarding this expansion. I release favor on you for this expansion, and that it is your time to just leap in and obey and run head on into this next phase of your business and ministry. So God bless you. That's right. Say, I hear you. I hear you. Thank you so very much. Again, we have 12 days of fasting that's coming up. Yours truly is about to celebrate her next decade. I'm about to celebrate my next decade. And so with that has to come some training, some discipline. And as I take those of you with me who God has coupled me to take you along, some things that you have to catch. No, sir, you can add another 10 to that. Praise the Lord. I'm not ashamed of my age. I'm not ashamed of my age. My goal is to take care of my natural self as much as possible. I like to put on some extensions, and I like to put on lashes every once in a while, and I like to have my face truly beat every once in a while, and business requires you update your pictures and stuff like that, but I don't want to live a life to where you see me in public and I'm unrecognizable. So you see me now wearing more of my, hair. You see me more, you know, in doing some things different. I'm still a work in progress when it comes to keeping myself up, fit, and you know, nutrition and exercise. I always tell people, live a realistic life, you know, 70-30. If you have a goal that, you know, you're trying to meet, your fitness and dietary wise, then you need to live 70-30. But if you are already at your goal weight and level of fitness and mobility that you want to be at, then you might be able to do 60-40. I don't know. It just depends on who you are. And it just depends on what age you're at. It just depends on your comfort, what's acceptable for you. So I still have a work ahead of me, and I thank God for his grace to empower me to not to give up on living a rich, full, anointed, healthy, prosperous life, right? All right. I love y'all so very much. Some of y'all have asked me what it is that I want. There is a media boot camp that I want to go through. There's a leadership training that I want to go to through. So I've registered for one of them already. If you want to sow to that, my PayPal is Natasha N. Davis. My Cash App is Natasha N. Davis, and you can PayPal me at N. Davis Ministries, or you could go over to my website, which is natashadavis.org. By the way, the fasting instructions will be uploaded to the website. So I am still putting the roster together for that. Some couple of people that I want to confirm with who are able to participate and join us. But the outline of what is included and what's not included in the fast is going to be posted on my website. And for those of you, there's already some stuff up there from the last 40-day consecration. We did a 7-day, we did a couple of 2 or 3 days. So all of 2020, we went through a course of fasting, and I heard from the Lord concerning the summer months where some children was out of school and the parents to spend time with them and giving people a chance to adjust to some things that was going on, COVID-19 grieving and things like that. But I heard him very specifically for 12 days. It's time to restore 12 days in the month of October. All right. So there are some things that I do want for my birthday, and I will continue to list those things. It's so much. It truly is so much that I could do to improve what I'm doing in the kingdom of God. And so making investments in myself and then you partnering with me to do that is great. So I really appreciate it so very much. All right. My Cash App again is Natasha N. Davis. Cash App, Natasha N. Davis. I'll put it up, pin it so you'll see it for any birthday wishes or anything like that that you want to do. And then you could always inbox me if you want to know something specific. But I will continuously post what I've already posted as far as, you know, my wishes or whatever the case may be. I really would appreciate if you just keep me in prayer. Keep my daughter Genesis in prayer. All right. Keep us in prayer. All right. I appreciate it. Thank you so very much, Brother Devin. To God be the glory for all he's done. The Lord bless you and watch over you. Over you all, everybody that will see this broadcast, the Lord be with you, guide you. May he speak to you in your spirit, man, your inner man, to know what practical and what idealistic trainings that he wants you to go through. May you hear the Lord. May you see the Lord. May you witness God do exceedingly abundantly above all that we could ever ask or think in this season. In Jesus' name, amen. I love y'all. I love y'all so much. Everybody, you have a great night. If you need to go, go. If you had any questions, you can go ahead and ask. If you need to go ahead and jump off, go ahead and jump off. I'll hang around for those of you that have any questions. Any of you that have any questions. No, no, no. Brother Devin saying, pray for the Cowboys. May the Lord watch. I'm not going into intercession for the Cowboys. You on your own with that one. Yes, I will have some people very mad at me about whether intercession help is needed right about now. That is so funny. All right. So does anybody have any questions for me? Any questions for me? Any questions about birthday stuff, about consecration stuff? About these sessions, about any of the sessions that I've done recently, any questions? Anybody that has to go, I'm not trying to keep you on, but anybody that wants to ask any questions, is this training for everyone? Yes, Sister Willis, I'm here each and every Thursday. Every Thursday at 7 p.m. Thursday at 7 p.m. And every Sunday at 6:30 p.m. Every week. And class is usually in session. That is my name. That is the name that the Lord just had me to give it these times together. Sometimes we come and just pray together. I'm led by the Holy Ghost. Sometimes I'm led. And then there are teachings. You could go to my webpage, Sister Willis. You could go to my website. My YouTube page is connected there, or you can run over to YouTube. I have plenty of teaching on prayer. I have a teaching on my website called Meditation, 7 points of meditation, and they're like maybe like 3 or 4 teachings in that series. There are several teachings on my YouTube page and on my website that is connected to fasting, that's connected to prayer, that's connected to lifestyle. There is plenty of resources there on the lanes that I teach in. Those are the lanes that I teach in. The Lord has graced me to teach in my lanes. And I teach in the lanes of prayer. I teach in the lanes of being equipped. Ephesians 4:12 is my foundation scripture. And so my role in the kingdom of God is to build. As a prophet, I'm called to build. This is the assignment that God, that's why I came on social media, is to build people that have callings on their lives, to build people who are desiring more information, more training. And so this is what my lane is. My lane is prayer. It is talking about and teaching practical principles of your giftings. Ain't nothing weird or spooky and deep going on over here. Is to bring to light some things that God is doing in each of your lives. And as the Lord permits me to do presbytery, then I do. But it is to give you some tools to equip you on how to live a victorious life, how to mature. I got some intercessors and some prophets on here and some people who God has their hand on, and he is he is sending them up as arrows, and as we continue to walk together, I believe that they are getting what they need. I mean, like some prophets that are in their maturing stages, and authors that are in their maturing stages, because such am I, an author that is in my maturing stages, a teacher that I am embracing more and more in my maturing stages as it relates to teaching the Word of God in a practical way. Thank you for asking that question. I want to answer some questions. Anything else? Y'all hanging out like y'all don't have to go to work tomorrow. Are there any other questions? Any other questions? I want to know. Inquiring minds want to know. Yes. Inquiring minds want to know. But if there are no more questions, I hate to let you go, but I have to, because we are well past our time being together. But watch the replay and share with your friends. All right. You said, I do know. I do. You said, I do. Just don't want to miss any nuggets. So this is what I want you to do. Sister Willis and Sister Peace Lily, aka London, or anyone else that's watching, and I don't know you're watching, if there are any specific trainings that you feel like would stabilize where you are right now, or would be a greater use, you know, you can scroll down my YouTube channel, of course, but if there is anything that you feel like that would really help you in your walk with God now, or just practical living as a believer, or anything like that when it relates to prayer, let me know. Let me know, and I'll be very prayerful about, you know, whether I am to teach that from a media platform, or am I to just refer you to some books and, you know, things like that, or am I to, you know, take a small class that's off social media, like on a registered platform or something, so we can have more liberty and privacy, because right now this is open to the public and anybody can see it. If we had our own localized space, what's going on, Deke? Deacon Johnson, if there is anything else that you need to learn, or if there's any burning, teachings, there's sometimes some things that I really want to know, and I just go in the search bar on YouTube, and sometimes exactly what I'm looking for don't come up. But I will look at enough videos and get enough clues to kind of piece together where I should be. So that's why I'm asking, you know, that's kind of where, why I'm asking. All right. So let me know if there are any topics, that you need to hear, you know, prophecy, prayer, your calling, you know, don't call and ask me for the win on lotto numbers and to pray for your team, Devin, all of that. That's not my lane. All right. So y'all let me know. I love y'all with the love of the Lord. See you later. 13 days, y'all. 13 days. All right. I'll see y'all on Sunday. See you back here Sunday at 6:30 Eastern Standard Time. Blessings, everybody.